In the last video, Introduction to Wave Optics, we have already studied the postulates of Huygens' theory, which describes how the wave propagates and how can we get secondary wavefront from the primary wavefront. Huygens' theory can be used to explain the phenomena of reflection. So here in this video, we will be deriving the laws of reflection using Huygens' construction. For the purpose, you need to recall the definition of wavefront. The wavefront is locus of points which are disturbed at the same time and are in same phase. This is what is important for any locus to be a wavefront. In order to verify the laws of reflection using the theory, let's consider a plane reflecting surface XY and a plane wavefront WW' progressing towards this surface XY with speed c. As the wavefront progresses, this wavefront WW' incident wavefront, as it progresses, first of all the energy reaches point A, which is disturbed, and gradually the points to E and then to B. All these points between A and B are successively disturbed as we move from A to B and as the wavefront progresses. So the time in which the wavefront travels from A1 to B, that is the incident wavefront, here this is extra time. When the incident wavefront reaches A1, it also reaches A, but from A the reflected wavefront starts immediately along AB1. The time in which incident ray reaches from A1 to B, the reflected light reaches from A to B1 and D to E to F and so on. When this D is any arbitrary point between A1, E is any arbitrary corresponding point between A and B and so on. So the time taken by light to travel from A to B1 is equal to time along D, E, F or equal to time along A1, B1. So that is what we have noted down here. First of all, point A is disturbed, followed by successive points to B. So time along A1B is equal to time along AB1 or time along DEF. BB1 is reflected wavefront if DEF time along DEF does not depend on position of E. That is, the time DEF for any point between A and B should be independent of position of E. Now let's calculate this time. The time is given by DE over C, that is distance over speed, plus EF over C. DE from the diagram is AB sin I. So you can write DE as AE sin I and EF as EB sin R from this triangle EFB. EB sin R upon C. Replacing EB by AB minus AE, you get AB sin I plus AB minus AE sin R divided by speed of light, that is C. AE you can take out common, you get AE sin I minus sin R, and this term AB sin R you can write separately. Now this is the expression for time taken by light to travel from D to E and then to F. This time should not depend on position of E. For the purpose, you know, if you want to eliminate, if you don't want E to affect the time, the coefficient of AE should be 0, that is sin I minus sin R should be 0. So for the time T to be independent of E, sin I minus sin R should be 0, which implies sin I equal to sin R or angle I equal to angle R, that is angle of incidence equal to angle of reflection, which is the first law of reflection. The second law, incident ray, reflected ray and normal, all lie in same plane, has a theoretical proof which we can understand from by looking at the diagram again. WW dash is a plane wavefront which is normal to the plane of the board. XY is a reflecting surface like a plane mirror and is again perpendicular to the plane of the board. BB1 is a reflected wavefront which is a plane wavefront and is again normal to the plane of the board. So the incident ray perpendicular to WW dash will be in the plane of the board. This normal AN perpendicular to XY will again be in the plane of the board. Similarly, the reflected rays which are perpendicular to BB1, they will also be in plane of the board. Hence, the incident ray, the reflected ray and the normal all lie in the plane of the board, which means the same plane. In order to verify the laws of refraction using Huygens construction, let's consider a plane refracting surface XY separating two media, medium 1 above it and 2 below it. C1 is speed of light in medium 1 and C2 is speed of light in medium 2. Let's take a plane incident wavefront WW dash is shown here, progressing towards the plane refracting surface XY. As this wavefront progresses here, first of all point A is disturbed, followed by the points successive to E, and then last of all point B will be disturbed. The points between A and B, according to Huygens principle, act as fresh sources of disturbance. So the waves will grow in medium 1 as reflected waves and in medium 2 as refracted waves. Since we have to verify the laws of refraction, we will neglect the reflected part. Now the waves, incident wavefront reaches points A, D and A1, that is all points on A1 at the same time. The time in which the incident wave travels from A1 to B, the refracted wave travels from A to B1. And for points in between A and A1, D, let's it be any arbitrary point between A, A1, the light travels from D to E and then to F in the same time as the time taken by light to travel from A1 to B or A to B1. So this is what we have stated here. Neglecting reflected part, the time in which the incident light travels from A1 to B, you can see the diagram, A1 to B, the refracted light moves from A to B1 or along DEF. So BB1 is refracted wavefront if the time taken by light along DEF is independent of position of E. Now let's calculate this time DEF for the light to travel along DEF. This time you can divide it to two parts, time along DE plus time along EF. So there is DE over C1, the speed in medium 1, plus EF over C2. So DE is from this right angle triangle ADE, DE is AE sin I upon C1. Similarly, EF can be written as BE sin R upon C2. BE, see the diagram, is AB minus AE. So BE you can replace by AB minus AE. Rest of the expression is the same. Now from this expression you can take AE common and this term AB we separate, AB sin R over C2 plus AE common sin I over C1 minus sin R over C2. If the time is to be independent of E, this coefficient of AE should be 0. That is sin I over C1 minus sin R over C2 is 0. This coefficient you have to put 0, which implies sin I over C1 equal to sin R over C2, or sin I over sin R equal to C1 over C2, which is a constant quantity because the light will have definite speed in medium 1 and in medium 2. Now for the second law, this sin I over sin R equal to constant is Snell's law, an important law of refraction. For the second law, that is incident ray, refracted ray and the normal all lie in same plane. You have to again consider a theoretical result or reasoning. The wavefront WW1 is not a straight line, but it is a plane wavefront which is normal to the plane of the board. This WW1 is normal to the plane of the board. So incident ray perpendicular to this wavefront is in the plane of the board. Similarly, XY, a refracting surface like surface of a glass slab, is again a plane surface normal to the plane of the board. Therefore, this normal AN will lie in the plane of the board. Similarly, refracted wavefront BB1 is normal to the plane of the board. Therefore, the refracted ray also lies in the plane of the board. Hence, all the rays, all the three, that is incident ray, the refracted ray and the normal, lie in plane of the board, which means the same plane. So we have seen how the theory given by Hygiene helps us to verify the laws of reflection and the laws of refraction.